When I went to McGill, this was in 1947, I went to the chairman. Actually, we all had these interviews with the chairman to decide a little bit about the program that we would follow. And this was Robert McLeod at the time, the chairman of the psychology department at McGill. And I entered the room and I sat down and he looked at my transcripts from Dartmouth. And he said, "How did we let you in?" And he said, "Before you can even think about social psychology, you have to do some experimental work. So what I suggest you do is walk down the hall and go into the office of this new professor that we've just hired from Orange Park, Florida, the Yerkes Primate Center. He's come here, and he is an excellent experimentalist, and he's the one that you should go and talk to and see if you can get into his courses." So I did. I walked down the hall and went into the office of this other professor, who turned out to be D.O. Hebb, who had just been hired, as McLeod said, from Orange Park, and the world changed for me. At that time, there were these two competing ideas. One, Lashley's, which everyone, I think, knows as mass action and equipotentiality, the idea being that all parts of the brain outside of these primary sensory motor areas are sort of equivalent in terms of their ability to mediate various kinds of various functions. They're equivalent and therefore, in that sense, equipotential. And that as far as the importance of any particular area is concerned, they were only important in terms of the amount of damage to the brain as a whole, such that small damage anywhere would produce very little effect. A larger amount of damage would produce a greater effect, but across the board on all kinds of cognitive and behavioral processes. And of course, major damage, major effect. But it was all a question of quantity. Against this view was the notion that, yes, localization of function is possible, but it was a different kind of localization of function. It wasn't the notion that we had sort of had prior to that period, that there were little islands of function, rather that there was interaction among these islands. And this is essentially what led to the notion of circuits in the brain and systems in the brain through which the interaction took place, rather than sort of indefinable waves of activity. What Hebb introduced was the notion that cells had to be assembled in order to carry information about the things that we saw, the things that we see, the things that we hear, that are sensory stimuli, auditory, visual, tactile, olfactory stimuli. And the synapses in which the cells participated had to become modified by this input in order to leave a trace in the nervous system that they had passed through, that these stimuli had been processed. This allowed for this notion, this theory, this idea of Hebb's, allowed for us to think about all manner of perceptual and mnemonic memory and behavioral processes in terms of the interactions among neurons. And it also allowed for the notion that there would be localization of function within the brain in a way that Lashley, and in his research, had argued so strongly against. Perhaps Carl Pribram had, next to him, the greatest influence on my research, because he was the one who taught me the skills that I needed in order to pursue this kind of work in the monkey. He came from Orange Park, not only having done his residency at Jacksonville in neurosurgery, and having been trained, by the way, by Paul Busey, but he brought with him the skills that he himself had picked up at Orange Park in, with Lashley and the others who were there, including neuroanatomy and behavioral testing, that is, the methods of behavioral testing. Without that kind of input, without that kind of training, it wouldn't have been possible for me to pursue this kind of work. We set about to study the effects of selective damage to the temporal lobe in both baboons and monkeys, and this project is the one that I actually did for my PhD thesis at Yale, but for McGill. That is, I got my degree from McGill. And of course, it was only possible, as I said, to do this kind of work because of the training that I had received at the hands of Carl Pribram. We had to remove different parts of the temporal lobe in order to determine whether there was a part that was particularly important for visual discrimination learning. And what we learned was that it was the inferior temporal cortex that was critical. More medial tissue, including the medial temporal lobe, which is made up of the hippocampus and the amygdala and underlying cortices, was not important for visual discrimination learning, nor was the superior temporal gyrus important. We present two stimuli simultaneously, side by side, and bait one of them and not the other, and the animal is simply allowed to choose. And of course, the baited stimulus may appear on either side of the test tray. And all the animal has to do from trial to trial to trial is to respond to the baited stimulus and to withhold responses to the unbaited one. Now, this is a fairly simple discrimination for the animal to make between two three-dimensional objects. And what we used in the case of animals with the temporal lobe lesions, rather, was painted patterns, which don't differ that much from each other, and therefore are much more difficult to discriminate. Animals can learn such a task, painted patterns discriminations, for example, in maybe 200 or 300 trials. That's over a period of several sessions, maybe 1 or 2 weeks long. After damage to the inferior temporal cortex, they took thousands of trials to learn the same task. And so we knew we were dealing with a really important function of the inferior temporal cortex that had not really been known about before. The inferior temporal cortex, which is so important for visual discrimination learning, we discovered, is far removed, however, from the striate cortex, which is located all the way back in the occipital lobe. And we were obviously puzzled for a long time about what the relationship between these two regions in the brain could be. That's what led to the cross-lesion experiment. And it was undertaken in order to try to understand how the occipital lobe and the inferior part of the temporal cortex might be related functionally or neuroanatomically. What we did then was to study that question, was to remove in one hemisphere the inferior temporal cortex, and in the other hemisphere to remove the occipital lobe, the striate cortex. So we now had damage to what the hypothesis was proposing was a system of interaction between occipital and temporal cortex in this way. That is, there might still be, after these crossed lesions were made, a pathway between the intact occipital lobe in one hemisphere and the intact inferior temporal cortex in the other hemisphere through the corpus callosum, the main forebrain commissure. To test this idea, after making the combined asymmetrical lesion, the occipital lobe in one hemisphere, the inferior temporal cortex in the other, we transected the corpus callosum to test whether the animal would now be unable to do the visual discrimination task that I described. And the answer was, that's exactly what happened. Prior to the transection of the corpus callosum, the animal was able to perform the visual discrimination task perfectly well. And after the corpus callosum was severed, was sectioned, the animal was unable to. And this gave us sort of our first clue about how systems in the brain might be organized. That is, how sensory systems in the brain might be organized, indicating that tissue in the association cortex might be dependent upon input from the primary projection area in a way that allowed for higher processing of the stimulus to occur. Leslie Ungerleiter and I continued the research on the projection pathway out of the striate cortex, looking at the effects of damage not just to the inferior temporal cortex now, but also the posterior parietal cortex, because of the possibility that it really was important for spatial vision in the same way that the in a complementary way to the inferior temporal cortex's role in object vision. And we found that damage to the parietal cortex, posterior parietal cortex on the one hand, and to the inferior temporal cortex on the other, produced a double dissociation in these two functions. That is, inferior temporal cortical lesions producing impairment in object vision but not spatial vision, and the converse for damage to the posterior parietal cortex. Based both areas depending upon input from the striate cortex for their function. Our view at the time was that the ventral visual processing stream, which is something that we are calling it now, but not at that time, which was in the mid to late 70s, was that this stream was important for perception and discrimination learning and so on. But what we didn't understand was how this activation of the neurons in the stream led ultimately to memory of the objects that it was processing. As you move down the ventral visual stream, the processing stream, from V1 to V2, from V2 to V3 and V4, and then into the inferior temporal cortex areas, TEO and TE, you can imagine now that in that 50 milliseconds that it takes for the information to go down this pathway, millions and millions of neurons are being activated by a particular object in the field, say like the pencil. And those millions of neurons are the central representation of the stimulus. And in a sense, that's what we use to see with. We wondered if there was a possibility that this ventral stream, ventral processing stream, projected to the medial temporal lobe, and in as a result of that projection, as a result of the transfer of information into the medial temporal lobe, it was possible to store the information that had been present in the processing stream itself. We knew from anatomical work that area TE in the inferior temporal cortex projected into the medial temporal lobe, and it did this by sending axons initially into the rhinal cortices, which is shown here in purple, and then from the rhinal cortices there were projections into the amygdala and into the hippocampal formation. And the entire medial temporal lobe had been removed in HM, the patient who was shown to have a very global form of amnesia. And so we looked at the effects of doing that kind of removal in the monkey in animals that had been trained on an object recognition task. They were indeed very severely impaired when they had to remember an object that they had been shown on that delayed non-matching to sample task, when they had been shown an object, say, 30 seconds before or a minute before. Their performance was down to chance. And so we had, for the first time, evidence that vision, visual perception, and visual memory were both dependent upon the processing within the stream and the projection of the information into the medial temporal lobe. Let me show you on this model of the human brain, which is life-size, precisely where the medial temporal lobe is located. If we take the two hemispheres apart, we'll be able to see the ventral surface of the temporal lobe. Here is the occipital pole. This is the location of the ventral visual stream in the human, running through the ventral part of the occipital lobe into the ventral part of the temporal lobe. And here is the medial temporal cortex, including both the perirhinal cortex and the entorhinal cortex a little bit more medially, and the posterior parahippocampal region located here. And if we look inside, we can make out exactly where the hippocampus is located. So let me just turn this for you and show you where the hippocampus is located. It's surrounded by the ventricle, the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle, and this is its location in this position inside the brain. When we tried to remove this initially in the monkey, of course, because it is hidden inside the medial temporal lobe, there's no way to remove it by aspiration
without damaging the tissue underneath, which is how you get at the hippocampus and the amygdala, which I meant to point out was located just in front of the hippocampus, hippocampal formation. So when in the monkey we tried to remove the hippocampus and amygdala, which is what our goal was, we of course had to penetrate this tissue and remove it in order to get at, by in order to approach these deeper structures.
When I talk about the medial temporal lobe, obviously it includes lots of different structures, lots of different components. The major ones are the amygdala and the hippocampus, but in addition, there is underlying cortex in the parahippocampal region. At the time that we discovered the effect of medial temporal lobe damage in the monkey, we had assumed, partly on the basis of the assumptions that had also been made with regard to the global amnesia in HM and the effects of hippocampal damage in other patients, that the responsible damage was to the hippocampus and perhaps to the amygdala as well. It took many, many years after that initial discovery to recognize that the responsible damage was in fact not the amygdala and the hippocampal and the hippocampus, but actually the underlying tissue. We looked at the effects of selective damage within the medial temporal lobe, removing in some animals, for example, the perirhinal cortex, and in others the entorhinal cortex, and in still others the amygdala and the hippocampus, which we were able to do by employing the technique of injecting neurotoxin into these deep structures, and so in that way not damaging structures outside of the amygdala and the hippocampus. And what we found when we did those selective lesions later on was that the impairment that we had seen after total removal of the medial temporal lobe was in fact due to damage not to the amygdala and the hippocampus, but to the underlying cortex. There is still some disagreement in the field regarding the role of the hippocampus in recognition memory, at least in the monkey as the way in the way we test it. And that is that Larry Squire and Stuart Zola have evidence that damage to the hippocampus itself will produce an impairment in this kind of memory, and we have been unable to corroborate that in our work. But I think that there is general agreement that among all the components of the medial temporal lobe, probably the perirhinal cortex is the most important for this recognition memory task. Memories that we had attributed to the hippocampus in the monkey were actually being mediated instead by the tissue underneath, the parahippocampal region. This was true not just for object recognition and vision, where the perirhinal cortex was found to be critical, but also in tactile recognition, in cross-modal recognition, that is, feeling an object and on that basis deciding which visual stimuli to choose because it matched. Object reward association, not discrimination learning, but one trial association between an object and a reward. And then there was another kind of memory that we thought was surely dependent initially upon the hippocampus, which turned out to be due instead to the functions of the posterior parahippocampal cortex, namely the ability of monkeys to associate an object with a place that the object had occupied. in a task that we call one trial object place association. In every single instance in the monkey, what we found then was that the hippocampus was not playing any role. Apparently, the hippocampus is simply not important for what we now refer to in the jargon is egocentric spatial memory. That is, memory that is spatial memory that is based upon our body being the anchor. So if something is to our left, or something is to our right, or something is to above us, or down below us, it's egocentric. It appears as though what the hippocampus is really important for is what we refer to in jargon is as allocentric memory. That is, where the animal, or we, respond spatially or to a stimulus in space based upon its relation in space to other stimuli, not to us. Allocentric, therefore. For example, in the Morris water maze, in which animals with rats with and mice with hippocampal damage show very severe impairment, that it is based upon the fact that hippocampus apparently is important for this kind of spatial memory, that is, making use of objects in the position of objects in the world as anchor points for their movements. So here in diagrammatic form is what we understand to be the relationships anatomically between the different parts of the medial temporal lobe. The reason for making this explicit is that it helps us understand not just how the parts are interconnected, but how they might give rise to a hierarchy of memory formation. Anatomically speaking, what happens is that inputs from the ventral stream, that is from the inferior temporal cortex, project into the perirhinal cortex, whereas inputs from the dorsal stream, which occupies the posterior parietal cortex, projects into the posterior parahippocampal cortex. These two areas, in turn, project to the entorhinal cortex, and from the entorhinal cortex, finally, there is a projection into the hippocampus and the hippocampal circuit. This is actually a hierarchical organization anatomically, and leads not just to input from these visual processing streams, but also projects back to them. The critical area within the medial temporal lobe for object recognition is the perirhinal cortex. Lesions to other regions within the medial temporal lobe have very little effect on object recognition. Similarly, the critical region within this tissue for place recognition memory is the posterior parahippocampal cortex. And again, we believe that damage in other regions of the medial temporal lobe have a little effect. Now, the perirhinal cortex and the parahippocampal cortex, both of which project to the entorhinal cortex, makes this a tentative or a potential region for associating object and place information so that they can be formed as an association in memory. And finally, all of these regions projecting through the entorhinal cortex into the hippocampus may lead to still higher forms of cognitive memory. Based on evidence that we and others have been attaining in human patients who have damage, selective damage to the hippocampus, we are beginning to think that the parahippocampal region is particularly important for laying down facts or knowledge about the world, whereas the hippocampus is critical instead for a higher order type of cognitive memory, which we refer to as episodic memory, or memory of the events of everyday life. We were puzzled, having found this severe impairment in recognition memory after medial temporal lobe damage. How was that the animals with the same damage were able to learn visual discriminations? So the way we examined this question was by presenting animals with many, many pairs of stimuli in a visual discrimination setup. That is, the animals were trained simply to respond to one stimulus, which was the positive stimulus, for example, and to avoid responding to a negative stimulus. And there were 20 such pairs. In each pair, one stimulus was positive and another was negative. And all the animal had to do was learn to respond to the one that was baited and to avoid the one that was unbaited, as it normally did in a visual discrimination task. Except in this case, what we did was present these many pairs, each on just a single trial within a particular session on that day, so that the animal saw each pair just once, and by trial and error was either correct on that initial trial or wrong. And then the next day we would present the same 20 pairs again with the same pairing, and the animal would have another chance to respond to the positive stimulus and avoid the negative one, and so on, day after day, with just a single trial on each pair each day, but then with 24-hour intervals between the trials. And when the animals learned this task, we were pretty sure that what we would find now, if we remove the medial temporal lobe, that they would not be able to learn 20 pairs of stimuli in this fashion with 24-hour intertrial intervals, because that put a great demand on memory. And to our shock and amazement, that's not what happened. We removed the medial temporal lobe, and the animals were absolutely fine. They performed just like normal animals in learning 20 pairs of stimuli. And this is what convinced us that there had to be some other mechanism than the projection from the inferior temporal cortex to the medial temporal lobe to support this kind of ability. We looked to see whether there was any possibility that a pathway from the ventral visual processing stream into the neostriatum might be responsible for the ability of the animals to perform this 24-hour intertrial interval task. This pathway is shown here with the blue arrows from areas TE and TEO and even as far back as V4 projecting into the tail of the caudate nucleus, shown here in dark red, and also into the ventral caudal portion of the putamen, shown here in green. So we injected ibotinate acid, a neurotoxin, into these structures, the tail of the caudate nucleus and the ventral caudal putamen, and found an impairment in this ability to perform the 24-hour intertrial interval task, and that the degree of impairment was related to the amount of tissue damage in the neostriatum. I think more and more it is now generally accepted that the projections from the ventral visual pathway into the neostriatum are critical for what we refer to as habit formation, a different kind of memory from the kind that is supported by the medial temporal lobe. Initially, there was a good deal of skepticism about the notion that the neostratum had any role in this kind of function. But based upon new evidence that is coming out both in animals and in humans, based on lesion technique and also on imaging, there is sort of a consensus growing that the neostriatum is really a critical component of a circuit, a system that plays a role in habit formation of various kinds and skill learning and so on. I might add that just very recently, in fact, I think published just this year, Larry Squire and his colleagues have found that patients with encephalitis that affects the medial temporal lobe in a way that produces damage to it that is about as extensive or even perhaps even more extensive than the damage that was inflicted on HM neurosurgically. Such patients who have global amnesia of the same kind as HM are nevertheless able over time to learn visual discriminations of the same kind that I just described for the monkey. And it really is an amazing feat because they don't recognize the experimental situation that they're in. They don't recognize the objects that they are responding to. They don't even know, to be sure, why they are doing what they do. But when they are asked to do something to a pair of stimuli that they have learned the reward value of, they do it. Remarkably. Dr. Vagakadam came across a number of patients who had not been diagnosed properly earlier, but turned out to have a memory impairment of a very special kind. They had, it turned out later, had hypoxic ischemic episodes early in life, and sometimes even at birth. And it was only noted later, when they became 5 or 6 or 7 years old and began going to school, that they had difficulty in remembering the events of everyday life. And the reason that it was so difficult to diagnose this impairment and actually identify it in the way that I just have is that they were not amnesic in the usual sense. That is, they were able to go to school, mainstream schools. They were able to learn to read and write. They had learned language from an early age, just like normals do, normal children do. And yet, and they were able to acquire information, knowledge about the world, sufficient to lead them to score on IQ tests within fairly normal limits, sometimes low average, but often average, and sometimes even above average. And so it was a very selective kind of memory deficit that they had, in the sense that they didn't remember the things that they had done during the day. They didn't remember appointments that they were supposed to keep. They didn't remember where they had placed belongings. They didn't remember messages that they were supposed to make use of. On and on and on. Their memory failures were really severe, so severe that they could not be left alone. What I expected was that we would find in the MRI scans that were taken of these children that there would be pathology in the part of the medial temporal lobe that we had found in the monkey was absolutely critical for all the kinds of memory that we had tested. And instead, to my amazement, it turned out
that the pathology was actually in the hippocampus, and the underlying cortices appeared to be quite normal. What we did was borrow a distinction in memory that had been suggested many, many years ago in the 70s by Endel Tulving, the distinction between semantic memory and episodic memory, or put in another way, the distinction between remembering facts or knowing facts and remembering events. And it appeared as though we might be able to make some sense out of the very different kinds of results we were getting in the monkey and in the patients by suggesting that the parahippocampal region, containing the endorhinal, perirhinal, and posterior parahippocampal cortices, was the substrate for fact memory in humans, or semantic memory. And that the monkeys were making use of this tissue for recognition memory based upon what we now began to refer to as familiarity. That is, they were familiar with the samples. We have spent a lot of time actually investigating one particular patient, John, who is now in his 20s, but is a favorite of ours because he is so cooperative and he is so bright. He has a really high IQ. And we have used him as a sort of a pilot in order to get some firmer footing before we move on to examining some of these issues in the wider patient population that we've been working with. And in the case of John, we know that his impairment is restricted pretty much to remembering the events of everyday life. He does get lost easily, so he does have this spatial navigational deficit, but he does have difficulty remembering messages, remembering appointments, remembering where his belongings are. He takes copious notes in order to try to help himself, but he often forgets where he placed the notes. Despite that, he is, as I indicated, has acquired an enormous body of knowledge. He is, for example, extremely knowledgeable about the government in the UK, and about all of the members of the cabinet and their special interests and their special abilities and their names and where they come from. And he pays a lot of attention to politics, so he is one can hold a very extensive conversation with John about this kind of information. So what we believe we have to do is divide memory up into the two categories that Endel Tulving taught us about many, many years ago, namely event memory, which he referred to as episodic memory, on the one hand, which appears to be the kind of memory that John is so poor at, as well as the other patients. And then, in distinction to event and or episodic memory, memory for facts or semantic memory or knowledge about the world that John and the other patients are so good at. And with that distinction in mind, we can at least begin to propose and this is still very controversial, but we can propose that these patients who have suffered hypoxic ischemic injury to the hippocampus early in life, sometimes reducing, most of the time reducing, to produce this kind of impairment, reducing the volume of the hippocampus approximately in half, so that they only have about 50% of the volume of a normal hippocampus bilaterally, that this is, that it is the hippocampus that is responsible for the kind of memory that the kind of normal memory that the patients have lost. Whereas the parahippocampal region, on the other hand, is the tissue that is mediating their preserved semantic memory or fact memory. As I say, this is just a proposal. We have lots to do still before we can feel that we have tested it adequately, and it may well be wrong, but it gives us some idea about where to go. I think that the important point to be made about memory is that there isn't just one kind of memory. We now believe that there are several different kinds of memory. And they fall into two general classes, one of which has been referred to as declarative memory, but for which I like to use the term cognitive memory, partly because I'm not sure what monkeys, which is of course the animal I work with, ever declare. And the other, which has been referred to as procedural memory in the human literature, largely, is one that I would like to call behavioral type of memory, where the memory is not sort of carried on the basis of observational learning, which is what cognitive memory is largely all about, but is carried in the responses that the animal learns to perform to stimuli because of various reinforcement contingencies or reward or punishment contingencies. So the animal has a system for performing various kinds of behavioral tasks that fall into several different categories, like habituation, various kinds of conditioning, particularly classical conditioning, and instrumental conditioning, which is another way to talk about habit formation and skill learning. So there are a number of different systems, that is, a number made up of different brain parts that form circuits that are important for each of these types of memory on the one hand, and then there are other systems that are important in the same way, made up of still other components of brain structures that are important for cognitive memory, which can be divided in turn into memories for single events, and on the other hand, memories for repeated events, which in humans we refer to as fact memory. I think it is true that there is just very steady progress, millimeter by millimeter, inch by inch, across the 55 years, because what we have been looking for is trying to chart this uncharted territory. Remember, we began with understanding very little about how circuits and systems were organized in the brain. And we now have at least some understanding of how that happens, of what that organization is all about. But of course, in the process of this, what I think is relatively steady progress, there are many disappointments, there are many valleys, and there are also many peaks. Not many, but a few. Many valleys and a few peaks. And I suppose that maybe a few of these might be something, in terms of the peaks, might be something like the discovery of the first pathway, the one connecting the striate cortex to the inferior temporal cortex. Maybe another was the first demonstration of that the visual system was actually divided into two, that in terms of pathways, there is a ventral processing stream, as we've talked a lot about, and also a dorsal processing stream that is important, as we've mentioned, in spatial vision. Another peak probably was finding for the first time evidence in the monkey of a role for the medial temporal lobe in memory. I guess that even though our interpretation of that finding was wrong, it really led the way to our current understanding of how complicated that system really is. And perhaps another important finding was this division of labor in terms of different memory systems in the brain, between a cognitive memory system on the one hand and a behavioral memory system on the other, both of which, I guess one might say, are equally complicated because they are both made up of many components and each does many different things. I'm not sure that Hebb talked very much about memory in the way we currently do. I think that it would be correct to say rather that Hebb laid the groundwork for thinking about assemblies of neurons that would participate in particular kinds of cognitive processes, such as perception and memory, but the thought process in general, which is what he was really interested in. And of course, we have only begun to make some inroads into understanding the thought process. That will still take a lot longer.